All right, we did respiration. Now remember, I told you that photosynthesis is in many ways the opposite of respiration. The chemical equation starts off with CO2 and some energy, and after many steps ends up with sugar and some oxygen. Okay, so in many ways this is the opposite of what we saw with respiration. There's two major parts to photosynthesis. The first step is to transduce that energy from being a sunlight, a electromagnetic form of energy, into a chemical energy. In this case, we're making ATP and NADPH. These guys should look kind of familiar to you. The ATP is exactly what we saw in respiration. The NAD has now got a P stuck in there, but this is a very similar compound to the NADH we saw in respiration. This is a highly energetic molecule that is used as an intermediate. ATP and NADPH are immediate energy, and usually the cell doesn't need as much immediate energy as it produces during photosynthesis. And so these kinds of chemical energies are put into a storage form, and that storage form is sugar. And so there's the first step, which are often called the light-dependent reactions, and then the second step, which is called the Calvin cycle, named after a dude named Calvin. In fact, his name was Melvin Calvin. I think his parents had some issues. Anyway, Melvin Calvin discovered the steps that are the second part of photosynthesis. These are occurring inside of the chloroplast. Okay? Remember that the chloroplast has all sorts of membranes inside called thylakoids, and those thylakoids can be pancaked up together into grana. Photosystem 1, the electron transport chain, and photosystem 2 are all parts of those light-dependent reactions, and those are actually embedded in the thylakoid membranes. The second part, the Calvin cycle, happens in the liquid that's around all of those little membranes called the stroma. And that's where the Calvin cycle, the light independent, dark reaction, some people call them, but I tend to call it the Calvin cycle. Okay? So energy comes in here, right? And water gets used in this first light dependent reactions, and oxygen is given off. It's only in the second step that we actually take in the CO2, and the end product is sugars coming off. So, transducing energy. What is sunlight anyway? Sunlight is electromagnetic radiation, and electromagnetic radiation comes in many different flavors depending on how energetic that radiation is. At the highest end of the energy spectrum are things like gamma rays and X-rays and ultraviolet rays. The reason why you don't want to get too many X-rays in a year is X-rays represent really strong electromagnetic energy, and because of that, that wild energy can cause all sorts of damage to your body. This is also why you need to make sure you wear that sunscreen, right? Because ultraviolet radiation can also damage your body. This is a highly energetic form of energy that rains down on us, which is a good thing because this is what keeps our Earth going, but can also be damaging. The visible spectrum is here, right under ultraviolet, and then we go to heat energy, also called infrared, microwave energy, the stuff that uses our cell phone uses and we also heat up our food with, and then lastly, radio energy, the way that we actually get sound from the radio station to our car radio, that's using radio waves. Okay, you'll see that the waves themselves have a long periodicity when they are very weak, and they have a short periodicity when they are very strong. Okay? The visible spectrum here, we've stuck right in the middle. So plants actually manage to capture that electromagnetic energy by actually having those photons hit different electrons inside of pigments. So pigments are chemicals that have a color to them. The pigments that are found inside of plants are chlorophyll A, chlorophyll B, carotenoids, and there's a few others that are found in plants, but the main one for actually capturing photons for photosynthesis are the chlorophylls and the carotenoids. And you'll see that the reason why plants are green is because these different pigments absorb all of the blue wavelengths of light and all of the kind of orangey red colors of sunlight and only reflect back the greenish yellow ones, which is why plants have the color that they do. In capturing that energy, what happens is that an energetic electron is released from that pigment. the electron gets replaced by actually splitting water, and that's why oxygen is produced by photosynthesis. We actually use water, H2O, pull off some electrons to use for this process, and the end result is some hydrogen ions and some oxygen. Okay? So we take that electron that we've then given the energy from an energetic photon to it, and then that highly energetic electron gets passed around to different proteins that are embedded in membranes in those thylakoid membranes. And as part of that, they build up a hydrogen ion dam and make ATP through a proton motive force, a lot like oxidative phosphorylation, but this is called photophosphorylation, okay? That electron loses energy as it does this hot potato dance among all those different membrane proteins. It gets passed off back to another photosystem, gets hit again by a second photon that re-energizes those electrons, and those electrons go through various processes that at the end capture a large amount of energy in the form of two NADPH molecules. So we are making both ATP and NADPH. We have transduced what was a photon form of energy into a chemical form of energy. And these are the light reactions. And they involve photosystem one and photosystem two. They were named according to when they were found experimentally, but they actually happen in nature, two first and then one. It's actually possible for one to happen by itself, but you don't get nearly as much energy out of it. And so, in general, plants seem to go through this kind of Z form of electrons going through photosystem two first and then photosystem one. Here again, photophosphorylation. So in that first set of steps in photosystem two, that energetic electron that was formed gets passed among various different proteins. Some of them are embedded in the membrane, some of them are mobile inside of the membrane, but they're passing around this energetic electron, and as part of that, they are pumping hydrogen ions to one side of the thylakoid membrane. When those hydrogens are allowed to fall back inside of the membrane, they produce from ADP and an extra phosphorus, ATP. Okay? Remember that the photosystem one part also makes that NADPH. So we've got two products coming out of our first light reactions of photosynthesis, ATP and NADPH. We're then going to use that ATP and NADPH, which is like ready cash, and instead we're going to stick it into a savings account, and that savings account is the sugar, okay? We do that through the Calvin cycle, and the Calvin cycle has three major steps to it. It's like a factory that takes ATP and NADPH and produces sugar. The first is called the fixation step, in which we take this handy widget called RUBP and add CO2 to it. So we're actually taking what is considered an inorganic carbon and sticking it to an organic molecule to make organic sugars. These organic sugars currently are very low energy sugars. We then reduce those sugars, and what we mean by reducing here is make them very energetic. We take this low energy sugar, we add ATP and NADPH to it, and make a high energy sugar. We get to keep one of the high energy sugars that we make, and we use the rest in the third step, which is called regeneration, in which we have to remake that handy dandy widget, the RUBP, or Rubisco bisphosphate that we started out with. Okay? This is actually a circular process. Remember, we start out with the handy widget, and then we have to remake the handy widget. Okay? So here's the handy widget in another form. It's a 5-carbon sugar. Carbons here are represented by these little red balls. Okay? There's a phosphate on each end. We take this 5-carbon compound and add 1 carbon from CO2 to it to make 2 organic molecules that each have 3 carbons to it. Okay? So you can imagine adding this little red ball someplace into the middle here and then popping it in 2 such that you end up with 3 carbons and a phosphate. Okay? So these are very low energy sugars. I'm going to make this into a high energy sugar by adding in energy from ATP and those NADPH that I made in the light reactions. The product of that is some now high energy 3-carbon sugars. We get to keep one for each time around the cycle, and the rest of those have to go back into the cycle to remake that RUBP at first. The enzyme, the actual protein that holds on to the two players here, holds on to the RUBP and actually holds on to the CO2 here, is called Rubisco. It's RUBP, and it can either carboxylase or oxidase that. And so Rubisco is short, it's an acronym for that very long name. And Rubisco is thought to be the most common enzyme on the planet. Every single chloroplast has many, many Rubiscos in the stroma. Each photosynthetic cell within a plant has many, many chloroplasts, and each plant has lots and lots of cells, and there's lots and lots of plants on the planet, and this is why we think that Rubisco is probably the most common enzyme. There are limits to how much photosynthesis a plant can do. This, I often refer to it as an alchemy. It's like making straw into gold or lead into gold or whatever your original easy to find component is. Instead, we're taking sunlight and air, turning it into sugar. I mean, you're getting something for nothing, right? But there's actually limits to photosynthesis. Photosynthesis requires CO2, water, and sunlight, and sometimes plants are limited for one of these ingredients. Sometimes they don't have enough sunlight because it's nighttime or it's cloudy or what have you, or maybe they're being shaded by another plant. Sometimes they're low on CO2. You'll remember that plants are actually coated in a waxy substance called a cuticle to keep them from losing water, but it also keeps them from being able to breathe in properly. And plants have special little openings in their leaves and sometimes on their stems called stoma, and if you have many of them, they're stomata, that can open and close to let different CO2 into its body. And so that can be limiting. And so whenever it opens up its mouths, it actually loses water, and so we actually find out that there's a trade-off between CO2 and water. So photosynthesis is often limited by either having enough CO2 in order to do the Calvin cycle or losing too much water. There are some special adaptations of plants out there. For example, cacti have this thing called the CAM pathway, and a lot of tropical plants, including corn and pineapples and things like that, have this other pathway called C4 that help them get around this process, this problem of the trade-off between having enough CO2 and having enough water. So, to wrap up respiration and photosynthesis, I just again wanted to emphasize that these guys are often thought of as different sides to the same coin. Light energy comes in to a plant cell, and in the chloroplast of that plant cell, organic molecules and O2 are produced. In the mitochondria of those same cells, those organic molecules and O2 can be used to make ATP, and as a product of those reactions, it makes CO2 and water, which are some of the things that have to then go into the process of photosynthesis. So you can see how light energy can get trapped as sugars within plants, and then with things that eat those plants, eventually all of that energy gets dissipated as heat energy. Okay? In both processes, both respiration and photosynthesis, you use this kind of proton dam to make ATP when you want to. In the process of respiration, this is called oxidative phosphorylation. And in the process of photosynthesis, this is called photophosphorylation. Okay? In both of these, there's a membrane. You take a bunch of hydrogen ions and make a high concentration on one side and a low concentration on the other side. You let those hydrogens fall back down their concentration gradient, and as part of that, make ATP. This process occurs in the mitochondrion when you're doing respiration, and it occurs inside the chloroplast when you're doing photophosphorylation.